Yes. So this standard follows the plan, do, check, act process. So you have to first plan the process, the documented information, the objectives, the quality objectives. All these have to be planned. And once the plan is completed, actions have to be taken to see that the plan is implemented. Do what is planned. And once actions are done, you have to check and monitor, measure and evaluate the process to see what level of compliance the actions have brought in. And finally, after you check, you have to act. So you see the results of your monitoring and measurement, and from there you will know whether your actions have gone in the right direction, have provided good customer satisfaction. If not, you have to implement corrective actions. So from the standards point of view, you have to plan the context of the organization, the different processes have all got to be planned. You have to do actions on support, operations, design, production. All these are the different actions which an organization does. So, and you do a check by internal audits, performance evaluation, and management review. And finally, from the checking, you get to understand areas which need improvement, which meet requirements. All these are understood by the checking done by the organization. And these are all outputs from your internal audit, management review, and performance evaluation activities. And from these checking, you act. Areas which need improvement can be acted upon. Non-conformities which were encountered in internal audits can be corrected. Corrective actions to correct non-conformities can be brought in. And continual improvement of quality management can be seen across the organization. This is the general plan, do, check, act, and the leadership is always central to this whole process. The leadership has to see that all these four different activities repeatedly happen in an organization, and employees are committed to continually improving the quality management system in the organization. Yes. So, as I told you, this standard has 10 different sections. Section 1 is the scope of the standard. Section 2, normative references. Section 3 are terms and definition. And from section 4, the auditable clauses of the standard begin. The auditable clauses begin with section 4, which describes the context of the organization. Section 5 talks about the leadership and their responsibilities and their accountability. Section 6 talks about planning for risks and opportunities. Section 7 on the support, the different support activity which are required for good quality management. Section 8, the most important section, about how you need to produce product and services, how you need to design them, are all defined in the operations. Section 9 talks about performance evaluation, which is mostly about the internal audits, how you measure, monitor, and measure improvement. And finally, you have section 10 on improvement, which deals with non-conformities and continual improvement. So let's talk a little bit about this high level structure. As I told you, this is now common in many standards. The commonly used is the 9, 14 and 45,000, which is the integrated management system. So the structure of all these three standards are similar, and the wording of the document is also similar. So this structure creates uniformity in the documentation, implementation, and audit efforts. And auditors are able to focus very quickly. It enables accelerated focus on the different aspects of quality management. There are lesser conflicts, and it avoids multiple implementation efforts and audit efforts. So it also prevents confusion and disorder, and optimizes time and resources. Resources are optimized. So when any organization planning to implement many different management systems, it becomes easy for the organization to implement multiple management systems. Yes. So I'll briefly run through the different requirements of this 9001. So as I already told you, it has 10 sections. Section 1 is the scope, the normative references, terms and definitions. And from section 4, you get the auditable clauses of the standard. Section 4 talks about the context of the organization, wherein you deal with the needs and expectations of the different internal and external interested parties. You define the scope of the quality management system and the quality management system as a whole, the different activities which you plan to implement in this standard. So the different issues all organizations face. The context talks about why an organization is in existence, the strategic direction and the vision of the organization needs to be clearly explained. So once these are explained, the different issues which the organization face are brought into focus, and the different interested parties, you can see the customers, suppliers, and regulators. So this standard talks about these people as interested parties. So employees are the internal interested parties in a given organization. So next we go to the leadership. Section 5 talks about the leadership of the organization. It is broadly classified into three parts. It talks about the leadership and commitment required from top management. Section 5.2 gives you how the quality policy has to be framed. See, the quality policy has to be framed in line with the context and strategic direction of the organization. It has to provide a framework for setting the different quality objectives, and it has to have a commitment to enhance customer satisfaction. So these are some of the important points of the how your quality policy has to be framed. And the different organizational roles and responsibilities are also defined in this section. Yes. So section 6 talks about planning action to address the risks and opportunities. Section 6.2 about the quality planning and planning for changes. So in general, I'll give you a broad